move relatively quickly through this so we've got more time for questions at the end. So the key question is bubbles, tops and stops. How can we tell when we're near the top of a market? How can we tell if a pullback is a buying opportunity or an opportunity to sell everything as quick as we can and protect our profits? I'm a chartist, as some of you probably realise. Therefore, my first stop is with a chart. I want to understand what other people are telling me. Everybody in the market knows a lot more than I do. And they're kind enough to give all that information to me every time they buy and sell. If we look at the Dow was a classic bubble. It was inevitable that the Dow was going to develop a pullback. So there are two trends on the Dow. The first is this upper trend line here. It's actually a long-term trend line that dates back to the recovery in 2009-2010. At various times, it's acted as a resistance level. It stops price coming up, or as a support level. As price comes down, it bounces away from it. That is what we would call the dominant or secular trend in the Dow. The short-term trend that developed in mid-2016 is shown with the lower trend line. We get a bubble situation when the market moves a long way above the main trend lines, as it was with the Dow. That's a bubble area that's sitting there. So there's a high probability the Dow would come back to that trend line, use that as a support level, and recover. If it broke below that trend line and that support band around 2350, 23,500, then we'd be starting to think about a change in the direction of the trend. But the pullback to that level and rebound, that set up a perfect buying opportunity for a continuation of the longer term trend. Now, fundamentally, if we go back to President Trump, part of President Trump's appeal is his long-term infrastructure program, for which he's going to borrow something in the region of $1.3 trillion. And we are all generously going to give him money to do that, because we buy US bonds and various other things. So he's going to go already take US debt, which is the largest debt by percentage terms of any country in the world, and that includes Greece and Italy, by the way, and add $1.3 trillion to it. So we're going to see a continuation of this long-term underlying trend in the Dow. But what we need to be alert for is end-of-trend patterns. At the moment, there is no end-of-trend pattern that's appearing in the Dow. There is a bubble pattern. It's come back. It's rebounded from those support levels. So we're still bullish on the Dow. And that's good for the rest of world markets. The key thing that we're looking for is a head and shoulder pattern. There are a number of end of trend patterns, we'll look at some more, but the head and shoulder pattern has become one of the more frequent patterns that appeared across both individual stocks and individual stock indexes. This is out of the Australian market from 2017 through to this week. So a head and shoulder pattern is formed first of all by a clear rise and retreat, the left-hand shoulder, followed by a rally. That's a clear rally. It's the sort of thing that would make you go, let me rephrase that. On this rise here, we'd be long. The fall is sufficient to make us go short because it's a change in the trend. And then the rally it takes place is strong enough for us to go long again because, again, it's a change in the trend. It must move higher than the left-hand shoulder. It creates a head, retreat, and rebound. We take the two lowest points between the shoulders and draw what's called a neckline. It doesn't matter if the neckline slopes upwards, horizontally, or downwards. The results are exactly the same. The beauty of it is that once the right-hand shoulder is confirmed, in other words, we have a rally and a retreat that drops below the projected level of the neckline, which is this line through here, this sloping upwards line, we measure the distance and projected down from the head to the neckline and projected downwards to give a downside target. It has around a 90% probability of being accurate. In other words, 9 times out of 10, the market will fall and hit those downside targets. It's a great way to trade short. What happens after that is a bit uncertain. Sometimes the market will continue to go much, much lower, as it did in 2008. Sometimes it will consolidate and rebound rapidly, as the Australian index has shown. However, the key factor is that you have the creation of this left shoulder, a head, and a right shoulder. And they are clearly defined. It's best seen on a weekly chart. Now, it's important because, A, it's a leading indicator of market collapse, particularly on a weekly chart, or a major change or interruption to the current trend. And that gives us an interesting contradiction in the Malaysian market, and I'll come to that in a few minutes. The other pattern we're looking for is a parabolic trend. Who's been trading Bitcoin? Anybody? Anyone prepared to admit that they've been trading Bitcoin? That's another set of questions. Okay, Bitcoin's interesting to me in the sense that Bitcoin has shown that it is compatible with standard technical analysis. In early January, I wrote a report for CNBC where I said that Bitcoin was in a parabolic trend. And the parabolic trends, it's actually not a parabola, it's a segment of an eclipse, but it's called a parabolic trend. Key factor with parabolic trends is that inevitably they move to the right of the trend line, and when they do, the reaction is normally a rapid fall of between 30 and 50%. Bitcoin, it hit the 50% mark. Oil, God, remember when oil was back at $150? Ah, they were good days for oil producers. Anyway, when oil collapsed past that parabolic trend line, it collapsed by more than 100%. Key factor, these parabolic trends inevitably move to the right of that trend line and they fall dramatically, usually 30 to 50% or more. Parabolic trends do occur in indexes. Not so often, but they do occur in indexes. More volatile ones, like Shanghai Index, for instance, or Hang Seng. But they also occur in individual stocks. This is the only methodology that I know that can accurately tell me when a trend is going to end. And the reason for that is that the position of the trend line doesn't change. Once you've calculated off its 3 points, that curve remains in exactly the same place. But every day, a new candle is added, and that candle moves closer and closer and closer to that trend line. And you can estimate exactly the date on which the next candle is going to move to the right of that trend line. That's when we close our long positions, and it's when we go short. It's a very profitable trading technique that we find. So we keep an eye on this for individual stocks, for individual commodities, and for a limited number of indexes. This is what we're looking for to tell us when a market is likely to collapse. The other pattern we see is a rounding top. Now, a rounding top is a long-term pattern, usually develops over 3 to 6 months. It's the sort of pattern where the market collapses quite dramatically and the media says, oh, we were caught by surprise. Only because they can't read a chart. Key factor for the rounding top, first of all, is that the rounding part, the semicircle, defines the top of all of these rallies. So they can be defined most easily with a circle. There's usually a support level, which forms the base of that. Measure that, projected downwards, gives us the minimum downside target. That's the FTSE. We don't see any rounding tops developing across our major indexes at the moment. What we do see is the potential for a head and shoulders pattern. Now, head and shoulders patterns are related to high levels of volatility. That describes our current market. So that's what we're really on the alert for.